this house. None other than the person of the Right Reverend Bishop Coletta J. Vaughn. Amen. Give God reverence for the presence of our pastor. Yes. None other than Shelly Williams. I'll be a little personal. I remember when we got to the cathedral, God was doing a great work in my life and he was maturing me quickly. And I would look for Shannon and I would say, Shannon, this yours? And she would say, no, brother, that's your mama. And I would say, no, Shannon, this thing is going to be yours one day. She would say, no, that's your mama. Y'all can preach and teach and do all that. I would just sit, but I thank God that she accepted it. Amen. Amen. And I honor God for her presence. Amen. 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 And I would be remiss if I didn't mention the favor of my life. Amen. 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 Of goodness. The four great phenomenal children. I thank God for the blessing of Denise Carter. Amen. But let's lift our Bibles. I don't want to prolong the moment. This is my Bible. This is God's word to me.
This is God's word to me.
Written from a supernatural being.
To a supernatural being.
I can do. What it says I can do. And it says I can do all things.
Through Christ Jesus.
That strengthens me.
I am.
Who it says I am.
And this Bible
declares that I am the righteousness of God
in Christ Jesus.
Amen. So today,
I have come
to receive,
to believe,
and I'm positioning myself, that wherever I need to be changed,
I will be changed
by the living. We're in Hebrews, the 6th chapter. Amen. We're gonna set sail at verse 10. Today I'm gonna be doing some teaching. This is first Sunday is Covenant Sunday. Yeah. Somebody look at your neighbor and say, it's Covenant Sunday. We're gonna take communion, but we're gonna deal with covenant today. Amen. One covenant that sometimes believers overlook. But let me pray and then read, and I'll let you rest on your seats. Eternal God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this day, God. Now, Lord, we ask that you would allow the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart to be accepted in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. God, I ask that right now you would have me behind your cross. And before I say a word, God, you say it to me. Holy Spirit, I ask that you would have your way. I yield so that you can lead. For you are the spirit of truth. The word of wisdom and the word of knowledge is you. So God, I ask that you would lead us now in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In Hebrews 6 and 10 it reads, for God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which ye have shown toward his name, and that ye have ministered to the saints and do ministry. And we desire that every one of you do show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope unto the end, that ye be not scoffers, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promise. Amen. We thank God for the reading and hearing of his word. You may be seated. I want to talk a little bit today from the topic of God don't forget.
Come on, sir.
Somebody look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, God don't forget. And if that's a little bit too simple, just tell them God remembers. Amen. Amen.
Watch out, sir. Watch
Amen.
Out.
God remembers.
Yes, sir.
I want to talk a little bit about the book of Hebrews, and then we're going to get right into our message. One of the things that's the purpose and the message of Hebrews was to get the Hebrewic Christians to fully leave Judaism and to wean them from going back. As we look at the book of Hebrews, we hear about a better covenant. We hear about a priest, Jesus, a better priest, after the order of Melchizedek. And the problem that the Christians, the newly converted Christians, or the people of the way, of the faith, the problem they were having was, as they was under pressure and persecution, some of them thought about going back.
Yes, sir. Right.
And so the writer of Hebrews, some say it was Apollos, some say it was Paul. It's a number of people who gets credit, but they don't really know who wrote it, so they just say the writer of Hebrews.
Yeah.
But they encourage the people, number one, that God don't forget. One of the things I realized in this life of salvation is the fact that for some reason, many of us believe that because I am saved, I am insulated from trouble.
Watch it.
Some of us believe because you get saved, that means trouble won't come my way. Because I'm saved, that means I'll be able to escape trials and tribulations. Because I'm saved, I won't find myself in the presence of manifold temptations. Amen. I do want to acknowledge the presence of our ruling there, but in case I didn't say, I want to say it again. Amen. And so as a result of many of us believing that because we are saved, we're supposed to avoid some of the pitfalls of life, we live in such a way that when trouble comes, we're surprised.
Yeah.
The writer of Ecclesiastes 3:1 says, there is a time and a season for everything under the sun. Yeah. There's some seasons where you're going to be in a storm. There's going to be some seasons where you're coming out. And if you're out, guess what you might be headed to?
Come on.
Amen?
Come on.
But in the midst of all you go through, just be mindful that God don't forget. Because I'm saved, I shouldn't have trouble. 2 Timothy 2:3-12 says, in fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. If you want to live a godly life in Christ Jesus, you're going to go through some persecutions.
Yes, sir.
Amen. And the evil people and the wicked people, they go from bad to worse.
All right.
So because you say, I just want to establish, does not mean you will avoid trouble.
That's right.
It's getting quiet then. Because I'm saved, these things don't always go the way I thought they was going. And peradventure, we have somebody here today that's been praying about a situation. I come to tell you that God hears your prayer, but he may not answer it the way you want to answer. I remember a few months ago, I was praying for a promotion, and I was praying to get out of the building I was in. It had become a bad situation. So I prayed, I said, God, I want you to get me out of this building. I want you to put me in another building. So one of my coworkers, she was praying for the same thing. And so my move came, and then word came for her move to come. And she got upset because God didn't do it the way she wanted him to do it. Unfortunately, when we pray, he hears us when we pray. But we do not have a monopoly on God in such a way that we can tell God how to answer our prayers.
Yeah. All right.
That's very important. That when we pray, God hears us,
yeah,
and he heals us,
yeah,
and he delivers us.
Yeah.
But we do not have the ability or the strength to tell God how to do it. Because if God do it our way, often many times our way will cause us to neglect and void the plan of God for our lives. Amen. Amen. So the first thing I want us to realize is God is not unjust. That's point number one. I'm a little Baptist, so point number one is God is not unjust. A couple of weeks ago, months ago, Bishop talked about us as believers need to settle the fact that God is good. Settle in your mind, settle in your heart, settle in the parts of your body that God is good. You will be surprised how many people fight every day with themselves about whether God is good or not. I get sick, and I don't know if God's good. My car breaks down, I don't know if God's good. My wife acting up, not my wife, I'm acting up. I'm acting up, I don't know if God's good. Advertise me, y'all. I'm just going to talk about me. I'm doing this, I'm just talking. Advertise me, I'm acting up. Amen. And so sometimes we wrestle with the fact that God is good. But I come to tell you, God is good.
Yes.
Whether you got a job or you don't got a job, with a house or no, God is good. God is good. And we have to settle that. I have a family member. Sometimes he goes through troubles. And one night he called me, and I just happened to be woke this time. He said, I don't believe God like that. He said, I really don't think God like me, though. He said, now y'all don't say this outside the church. He said, Juju, I really don't believe God like me. Because you know, in the family, titles don't mean nothing. It don't mean nothing. And I said, why you say that? He said, man, I'm telling you, dog, every time I try to do something, I get on the right road, something happens. God don't like me. And the fact of the matter is, many of the people we deal with have that same conscience that God is either not good or God don't like us. So I come to settle it that God is good. And not only do he like us, he's in love with us.
Amen.
Now let me let you know how I know God is good. The Bible says in Psalms 18 that he's my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. In Psalms 23, it says, he's my shepherd, and that's what I want. In Psalms 27, he says, he's my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? In Isaiah 65:24, it says, God answers us before we call. He says, before they call, I will answer, and while they are still speaking, I will hear. In Psalms 63, it says, God is holy. In 2 Timothy 2:12, it says, God is faithful. In Matthew 28:20, it says, he's a promise keeper. He said, lo, I'm with you always, even until the end of time.
Yeah.
In John, we see that God is a counselor, he's a comforter, and he's the spirit of truth.
Yes, sir.
If God is all that, it's no way impossible that we can even begin to wrap our mind around the idea that God is not good. God is good.
Yeah.
And he's real good, and he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him.
Yeah.
Things I believe that really causes some of us as believers, I know y'all don't struggle sometimes. I believe one of the reasons why sometimes we struggle is because we get out of faith. I spoke the other week in my testimony about how I had got to where I've got. I had got a promotion, y'all. I had got a raise. We've been in our house a year yesterday. And I had been riding the high, I was on the high.
Yeah.
But I didn't prepare for the storm.
Yeah.
And so I said, God, how did I end up here? How did I get here? And oftentimes when I'm in the shower, that's when me and God do our best conversations. And he simply said, you didn't stay in faith. Had you stayed in faith, you would not have found yourself in the low that you were in.
Yeah.
And sometimes I hear you, Holy Ghost.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Sometimes we wonder why we can sleep all day. The reason why some of us sleep all day is because we're depressed. You ain't that tired because you ain't working at home.
You're depressed.
You're depressed.
Wow.
And so the only way you can live this amazing life is you got to stay in faith. Because without faith, it's impossible to please God. I know y'all think holiness is it. I know y'all think service is it. I know we think knowledge is it. I know we think wisdom is it. But the only thing that pleases God is faith.
Yes.
If faith don't make sense, faith make faith. So God does not forget. God is good, right? That's what I said. And he does not forget our labors of love. Number two, God remembers. What is a labor of love? I know to some they may think the labor of love is preaching and teaching and standing behind the sacred desk, feeding the homeless and everything. But what is labors of love? What does it look like? Somebody help me. What does it look like?
All right.
Labors of love is giving your time, your talent, and your treasures.
Yes, sir.
I can recall years ago when I was in grad school. I was working full time, I was in grad school, I was teaching Bible study full time, Bishop was traveling all over the world, I was preaching full time, I was doing everything all the time, full time. And my grades never slipped.
Come on.
Because I did it by faith. I did it by faith. And the fact of the matter is, unless some of us really really get surprised, God remembers the good and the bad. And the fact of the matter is, some of us, and I'll preach this way, some of us need to re-evaluate our covenant with God when it comes to tithes and offerings. Tithes is a covenant. It's the only covenant in the Old Testament and the New Testament where he said, if you follow it, I will rebuke the devourer for your sake. It's nowhere else that God gives a promise that if you do this, I'll rebuke the devourer for your sake. Some of us wonder why things are not going right for us. Why is it that every time I turn around, it's this or that? It's this or that? The fact of the matter might be, it's this or that. Could be because you have broken covenant and fellowship with God when it comes to tithe and
offering.
Our commitment to the tithe is our covenant. If you show me somebody who tithe, I'll show you somebody who bless you.
Come on, sir.
If you show me somebody that tithe, I'll show you somebody that's blessed in regards of what they go through or what they dealing with, they're blessed. I wonder, we took a big hit last year in 16. I don't know where I would be at if I wasn't tithe mentally after 16. We lost some great people in 16. We went through some tragedies in 16. I almost had to question myself, is God really good after 16? I'm just telling y'all how I feel. I cried harder at 16 than ever cried in my life. I could not be comfortable in 16, but one thing I know, I'm standing here because I'm a tithe. I'm standing here in my right mind and clothes because I'm tithe. Because he said he will rebuke the devourer of himself. Some of us really look at the matters of life, the labors of life. If you ask yourself, how am I doing? Look at your tithing record. Look at your tithing record. God, remember our vows. I remember there was this king in the Old Testament by the name of Hezekiah. And at a young age, when Hezekiah became king, I'm believe Hezekiah became king at the age of 24. He was king for 25 years. So once he became king, the Bible says in the book, chapter 18, verse 3, 2 Kings, it says, and he did what was right in the eyesight of God. The first thing he did once he became king, he knocked down all the idols and got rid of all the idol worship. He did everything in order. But I know he was a giver as well. We fast forward two chapters up, a few years later, the kingdom is doing well, God is pleased, and he becomes sick. I'm talking about God remembers. He becomes sick, and the fact of the matter is, Isaiah goes to his house to tell him, you need to get your house in order.
Come on, sir. Come on.
And I can just only imagine the mindset and the understanding of Hezekiah. How is it that I'm living for God and I'm doing things right? I brought the kingdom back to a godly state, and now you come and tell me I'm going to die. The devil is alive. It is moments like that, if we're not careful, that we will cast away our problems. We learned last week, not because we're upset, but just sometimes life just
happens.
Here we are, I'm the king, and brought godly standards and statutes back to the people of God. And now you come and tell me, I'm got to get my house together. I'm about to die. And the thing about troubles in life is that when troubles come, we don't need to run from God, we need to run to God. So I can see Hezekiah, I remember years ago, I was sick with diverticulitis. And my intestines had swollen in such a way that now my stomach was putting pressure on my heart. I was low sick. I was on my way out of here. And I had a conversation with God. And I can hear Hezekiah say, God, remember all I've done for you? God, remember what I've done? Remember how I've kept your covenant? Remember how I've kept your statutes? And after Hezekiah got through praying, looking at that wall to God, the Bible records that before Isaiah could get to the middle courts, he had to turn back around and tell him God's going to be 15 more years. I'm going to tell you, God remembers. In spite of what you go through, in spite of what it feels like, God remembers. He remembers. And the fact of the matter is, he remembers the good, the bad, and the ugly. But the assurance we have is, if I'm right, Isaiah 43, it says, I am he who blots out your transgression. And for my own sake, I will not remember. Some stuff God just throw out the way. And there's some stuff we need to fix and correct right now. Some of us know we have not been taught. Some of us know we have not been committed to handling our responsibilities. Because this is a Bible church, we declare all biblical ignorance. In Acts the 5th chapter, there was this man and this woman. They was husbands and wives. And they had a piece of property. And they had sold the property. And so they brought some of the money from the property and gave it to Peter. And Peter looked and he asked. He said, now, is this what y'all sold the piece of property for? He was giving them an opportunity to get it right. And Ananias said, we did. And he said, why do you lie to the Holy Spirit? To the Spirit of truth. And because he lied, he died. And he stayed there. I think the Bible says about 3 hours later, his wife came. And he asked her the same question. Is this what your husband said? And she said, yeah, that's it. And he told her, the man that carried your husband out there at the back door, where he went to. Church, we got to stop lying in regards to our finances. It is true, denying that the 10% is God, but denying he is his Lord. He the one that gave us the strength to get it. many times we come to church and we date God and we play with God, but we're not in covenant relationship. I remember years ago, 23 years ago, when I first met Sister Vanessa Marshall. And I lied to her, but she really didn't like me. And I would give her gifts, buying coats and clothes and everything. And my sister was like, this boy gone, y'all. But I only could go so far because I wasn't in covenant relationship with her. And so I remember we would go to her house on weekend visits. And her father played dominoes. And I would play dominoes with her father, and she would always root for her dad. And I was a clown, but I'm like, you're my baby. You know what I'm saying? Look at me. But the fact of the matter was, she wasn't in covenant relationship. Some of us are dating God and playing with God, but we're not in covenant relationship. Tithe says that I'm in covenant relationship. And because I'm in covenant relationship, I get covenant blessings. The Bible says, now, if you give in the mouth, he said he'll open up the windows of heaven and pour you out blessings that there will not be room enough to receive. He also said he'll rebuke the devourer. Now, I know sometimes we catch, you know what, in this thing called life, but I wonder what would the trials be like if I wasn't covenant relationship with God. I wonder how long the loans would be if I wasn't in relationship with God. If I wasn't giving my tithes, if I wasn't giving my offering. Amen. Come on, y'all, we gotta get this thing right. And then we sometimes we borrow from the tithe. Y'all looking at me like, I'm lying. God remembers. And if you borrow, you need to pay it back with interest. The Old Testament, I think it is about the book of Leviticus. It talks about giving that you owe and then a fifth part of it as well. But why do you want to rob such a good God? God remembers. He remembers the good. Amen. And he remembers when we fall short. But the thing about God that's so phenomenal is he gives us an opportunity to repent and get it right. Now, I want to tell you about another person who God remembered. Now, if I was going to hoop, this would be the time I hoop y'all. I ain't hooping today, I'll teach you. King Saul, I ain't going to do it. King Saul. King Saul had a son named Jonathan. And Jonathan and David had a tight relationship. They loved each other. They was tight. They was boys. I mean, it was like, that's my guy. And so the time came when they went into war. And at this time, Jonathan had a son named Mephibosheth. I feel it already in my heart. And so Mephibosheth was a young man. And in the haste of them running, trying to avoid the dangers, he fell and his feet was messed up. He was crippled, and because he was crippled, they caused him to go into a place called Lo Debar. I mean, everything that was low down and down low was in Lo Debar. All right. But somehow God remembers. And the day came when David had finally become the king. He brought everything back in order, and he asked his servants, is there anybody here from the house of Saul and Jonathan who I can show favor to? And there was a servant named Ziba, Z-I-B-A, who remembered Mephibosheth. And she said that Mephibosheth is alive and son, and so he said, go get it. Now, the thing I love about God, because he remembers, was it was not that Mephibosheth had done anything well, but he just happened to be the right man's son.
See, some of us walking in places and having grace, not because you've been that good, but because mama was that good. The Bible declares in the Old Testament that he'll, the righteous will go down to 1,000 generations. Some of us are blessed because our people were blessed.